Lucy and Pat are now Mr. and Mrs. Patrick John Nugent. The president formally surrendered his daughter to her new husband less than an hour ago at the Shrine of the Immaculate Conception. And the marriage ceremony itself ended at 12:42 Eastern Daylight Time. Since then, the newly married couple have been participating in a high-nuptial mass. It has been a colorful, splendid, even magnificent occasion. Although in today's mid-80s temperature, some of the formally dressed members of the wedding party may be glad it's over. Still, it's an occasion no one will forget.
Pictures of the bridal party to be taken, standing in or passing through the receiving line of the White House, toasts to be toasted, dances to be danced, and cake to be either eaten or slept on. That choice will depend on the degree of your hunger and or sentimentality. But the day that we're calling Lucy's Day is far from over. We had a couple of tips about what had happened during the ceremony. Liz Carpenter, Mrs. Johnson's secretary, ran downstairs and said that when Lucy and her father walked down the aisle beneath surrendered her to Pat, she turned around to her father and gave him a little pat as though she were saying goodbye to him. And then when
you mean not a little pat, but a little pat on the cheek.
You're paying attention and I'm proud of you. When they were standing for the ceremony, or just before the ceremony, Lucy was so nervous that she was visibly shaking. And she had held her little firm chin out, though, and she was looking up at the magnificent mosaic of Christ. Pat was so moved that he took out a handkerchief and wiped away some real tears during the ceremony. And then also, Bob, very likely, two of them, I think, when it came time for their responses, Pat could hardly be heard. His voice, in fact, couldn't be heard. His lips moved. But Lucy's voice came through loud and clear.
Isn't that usually the way, as I recall, most of the weddings I've attended, the woman somehow manages to get the words out beautifully, and the man seems to be somewhat, well, I don't want to say reluctant, but he's quiet about the whole thing.
It's just what we've been saying all along. It's Lucy's Day.
Betty, during the near frantic activities of the past week, Lucy and Pat did manage to squeeze in time for an interview. Let's listen to it.
Lucy, I think you said at one time or another that this was not love at first sight. Could you tell us what did happen on that first sight or first date?
I don't mean that in a derogatory way. But the situation was so difficult, I can't imagine it.
Okay, what?
A similar situation, how it could ever have been.
Yes, we give him a crack. Up in the air.
Patrick met me here in Washington.
Ostrich Hill Repute and Steve Reeves.
You know the beta with Steve Reeves.
Well, he sure wishes he could. Yeah.
It was a very,
well, I really think he's
busy weekend, very hurried weekend, and so we either got along
and to other people,
easily,
and he's very violent to his
and we got along very easily, and that's, I guess, how it all started.
He's very false, like he
wasn't really first sight, because Lucy had another date that night. Self-explanatory in itself.
Those of us who have business dealings with your future father-in-law sometimes find him a little formidable. Has that been a problem for you? For instance, the traditional asking for a girl's hand, how does that go when you have to ask the president?
It was the same as it were for any other girl. It wasn't difficult. I was nervous. I told you I weren't nervous, I'd be lying. Is it bad? No, but it went very well. And everything worked out just fine.
We were going down to Texas, and there had been reports that we're going down there specifically to ask him, to talk to him about it. And we had no intention of doing so. And if we had, it would have been a difficult way to do it, I mean, because when the whole world was doing it, Daddy came back and called us in and said, well, what's this I've been reading about in the newspapers? And Patrick sat down and we all talked to him, and here we are.
Lucy, could you tell us about the house that you and Pat are going to live with when you go to school and start off?
Well, it's a lovely place. For me, it's like a dream house, possibly, because it is my first house, and I think a whole dream place with Patrick would be a dream house to me. I described it in the past as the house that you dream of, and you're a little girl looking around, and your mother's tigers, and dreaming of the day that the man in the white stallion is going to come off and take you to the other land. But it definitely has its practical aspects, and since I've learned about closet space and places to keep linens and cupboard space and things of this nature, and it's adequate for us, and yet it's not above our heads.
That's a question, of course, that people are interested in. I think you've been quoted, Pat, as saying you're going to live on your paycheck. This is before you decided to go back to school. How does that affect this decision or this wish?
Well, it really doesn't affect it at all, since I have managed to put away an hour and we'll be fine for a year or so.
There's one question that the law says I have to ask in this kind of interview. How big a family do you want, Liz?
Well, we'd like whatever the good Lord chooses to give us.
Is there any argument about that on your side, Pat?
No, sir, there isn't. I can't argue with the Lord.
Lucy, I think you've been quoted saying you're going to name your first child Kimberly. Is that right?